my video. Back again for the second time. In case you sort of noticed there, I am kind of tuned down a little bit, and I tuned down to a D, and I'm playing an E position, but I'm tuned to a D because of the effect of, I like the low sound of a guitar. And if you want to tune up with me, we can do that right now. Your E string will become a D string. Your B string will become an A string. And your G will become an F. What is this string? This is... this is your... anyway, whatever it is, it becomes a step lower. And then a step lower on each one. Mellow sound when you're playing with acoustic, at least I like it that way. It also makes it a little easier to bend strings and just gives you an overall better kind of feel for doing what you're doing, and it's easier on the fingers. And you can use heavier strings and still get what you're after. Most of the stuff we're going to be doing today is kind of laid back and nothing real flashy. Basic stuff like when I started out was on acoustic, and I think it's very important to learn how to do rhythms and accompany yourself with some lead stuff, some rhythm stuff, some almost bass run stuff. And if you noticed in this song that I just did, some of the stuff was like that. You run it together, which is, I'll do it one more time, slower like that. But, sort of a, like a piano sort of influence style of guitar, where like I used to listen to Ray Charles a lot in my early days and hear all that gospel kind of piano stuff and loved where the piano did this and this, pedaled with it, you know, and you keep pedaling on your single notes, especially if you're an E, which I like a lot, because it gives you a lot of open effects when you're playing on acoustic, I think. Most people are playing acoustic by themselves, and when you're playing by yourself, you need a lot of openness and fullness to give you the real feeling. And another thing we'll be mentioning is about, like, if you're writing songs, and for writing, I always write first with the acoustic, then transfer it to electric. And that's pretty much what today's going to be about with this. There's nothing... a whole lot of blah, 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 blah. We did that on the first video. If you want to hear that, you can get that one. But today is going to be basic chord structures. We're going to go in some tunings that gives you a different feeling for stuff later on in the show here. But right now we're at this point, and that's where we're going to stay for a while. So I'm going to talk a little more about the stuff with the bass stuff with your thumb and... most of this is with my fingers today. I'm not going to be using a pick. And so the whole idea is like that little section that we did at the front where it went that... but I'm sure you heard a lot of times on piano that same kind of gospel sort of lick. And it sounds great on guitar, too. And it'll inspire you, especially if you're a frustrated piano player like myself who can't play. So I'm gonna do it one more time here just to show you. I mean, you get the pedaling where you keep, like, your high note, you're pedaling, and you go. One more time. And it's really sort of gospel-style piano played on a guitar. But when you get into that kind of stuff, I think it's very important to learn all the rhythm stuff first and get if you're playing, you know, straight old stuff like this or whatever, you know, but get your rhythms and throw a little lead in once in a while, and then if you're playing with a band, of course, you can reach out and do all the wild stuff. But if you're sitting by yourself, you need a little more fullness, and this is kind of full stuff that I enjoy it. It inspires me, and I hope it inspires somebody else. And while you're doing things like that, there was a couple places in the song, you know, where I'd go to a league. You know, while you're playing along. And so you can break and go ahead and do some of that as long as you keep that rhythm thing flowing in your mind and then come back as often as you can without driving yourself crazy. And like on the ending of that was another lick I'd like to show you, because it was one that took me a while to figure out exactly what they was doing, and it turned out it was like the trees for the forest kind of thing. It was so simple, it was looking right at me. But Ray Charles did a lot of things on endings where he would, you know, and it was always that pedal piano thing. And I'll do it one more time so you can see it up close, and it's just really like hitting an F major seventh and just moving it up to a, and there again you're pedaling, you know. Or you can start out with plumb up a G fret. Good endings. And another part that I did in there was I did a section was like a, if you kind of notice, that's taking other instruments once again and trying to influence them over to guitar. Like that would be like a horn section, whole section on horn section, doing those kind of licks. And I've done a lot of records myself where we didn't have horn sections, but we'd take like the keyboards and the bass and the drums and everything and punch them all together. And you, again, you're trying to do fullness, so you're doing the whole chord, you know, to give you the, if it was a whole section, and you just sort of punch it and think horns. So it's very important, I think, to not just, sometimes you'll be looking on guitar and you won't find exactly what you want because it's really another instrument doing it. And you can use any instrument, but in this case right here, it's like a horn section. I'll do it one time through so you see what it is. Coming out, so you got time to do the horn section, then you can do like a real guitar lead, and then you're back to playing your melody with your bass and stuff. And I've found, you know, that doing that kind of stuff, you hear all this stuff in your mind, but sometimes you can't, it ain't there. So it's very important to get in your mind to understand other instruments, and while you're playing, almost being a producer and an arranger at the same time in your head, and your mind can hear all that stuff. And so you just got to sort of train it to hear it, and then it keeps you together, keeps the rhythm going, and helps a lot, especially when you are songwriting. And this particular song here is a song that I'm writing called Putting Down the Heavy Load. And it's not out yet. You'll hear it someday. You like endings with stuff like that. You know, you can put in different kinds of endings. In this place here, you'd have to be kind of similar. But like if you're coming out, you know, and you're doing that thing. You could do things like that and break it down to a more of a halftime feel for the ending, or as you're just coming out, you could go like a, putting in some guitar licks, some of like the horn licks, and then coming back with just straight chords. You could go to numerous places. I mean, you could go all over the place if you wanted to, you know. Yeah, and do stuff like that, you know. So endings are important too. Everything's important. But I think the most important is trying to keep your rhythms and your leads and breaking up and keep that time and all those thoughts in your heads of all these other things while you're hearing it, and your mind will start hearing noises at all times. When I was learning how to play, like I said, on acoustic, you know, we didn't have all the other stuff. This was a long time ago. And so something with acoustic, you always try to find a place that was had lots of reverb, you know, so you could hear it better. And that's why I got into listening to all these things. So, because just to sit around and play, you know, with whatever you're playing, even if it's in some kind of play, it just didn't have the same feel as when I got down to the fingers and started thinking, well, you know, I'd like to hear the bass do this or whatever, and keeping that steady time. Time is very important to really have your math together, you know, and then keep that timing going, because it makes a difference. It'll make a difference in any bag, any place you're coming from. I started off playing, you know, in a lot of G's and C's and D's before I went on up to E's, and I got in E's and got stuck there, but that's the way it goes. But I hope some of this helps you in this area. One of the early influences of all that I stumbled up on when I was searching around for things, trying to find someone who was playing that way, was Merle Travers was doing a lot of that thumb finger stuff, you know, where he mostly thumped it like that. And then I got into some of the old black musicians that was doing high for that, where they just was doing one note, you know, and then you could actually walk, you know, and do that. Then trying to get this finger. Usually what happens, I found that most of your picking when you're doing that, you'll find with your finger here, you'll pick up a lot, and this one's picking down, and so you start pulling at the strings, and you can actually muffle sometimes with this if you want more muffles down, and still keep this one open, or ask, you can sometimes muffle this down too while you're doing it. Come down, or you can take them together if you want to. If you want a real bite, you can just grab it with both fingers, and like Albert Collins likes to do that a lot. So while you're doing all this, you know, you can do all kinds of different things while you're playing. If you're keeping a steady rhythm, go to two fingers and keep the bass going and bend. I mean, there's just numerous things, you know. Everybody knows that lick, but playing that lick while you're still playing the bass part gets interesting, you know. Time keeps that foot patting and all that, you know. So it's fun too, on top of everything else. Okay, I'm gonna change things around a little bit here and do a different tuning. I'll just tune it down with you here and tell you what I'm doing on your A string, which is actually a G string, is gonna go down to an F. String, which is actually now a D string, is going to go down to a C. It's pretty easy to do. Sometimes you can do that, it'll throw some of your other strings off. You might want to check to be sure. Something in this, and I'll explain some about what I'm doing in a minute here. Thank you. that's in a, what I call a G tuning, and within that, again, it's back to the same thing of doing the rhythm thing along with the lead thing, and throw in a little lead here and kind of light on that. But it gives you a whole different idea of sound, because your chords become same positions of chords. I mean, like when you go up here to this chord, it's really like playing a straight E chord, just moving it up. And I'll show you all of which one of these chords relate to a certain pattern within that. But as you can hear, it's still keeping that bass thing going with your high end going. There's still the pedaling thing going, and all the different combinations. And then I've written a whole lot of songs that, just because this gives you a whole different feeling of chord structures. Once again, it's like, it's when it gets into slower versions of that, it's like a lot of almost folky Jackson Browne kind of chords that a piano player might play again, which will come on up a little bit later. We'll talk about, but I know we're going to talk some about playing in this. Like, if you notice, like I'm still doing that bass thing. So. It's almost like funky. Well, actually, I did a song called Funky Country Living and used this in it. So you're not limited to one place. You can actually play a little bit of lead work with your bass in, where you can do. And do some things like that on the low end while you still keep. Very important while you're doing that to keep. Then your rhythm becomes with your finger down here. Of keeping your rhythm thing going here, you know, like this. And while you're playing, if you go up to lead with your bass, then you play your bass kind of thing with this one down here, which becomes a pedal. And so an example there is what I was just doing is like a. Off of that, and you go back down here, then your bass gets steady again. And you can also push like I'm doing now. That almost gets kind of country. It's almost sort of, when I came up with this, it was sort of like almost a banjo type feel. And so thinking in my early career, early life, when we was playing bluegrass music and different things, and I got into banjo, so this is almost a banjo tuning, with the exception of that note, which should go down, you know, to oh wow, wherever it goes to, but the top part is like a banjo, and it gives you that banjo feel. So, and a lot of your, if you're thinking funky country or anything like that, and you start doing that plucking stuff, you know, like if it was a banjo, you could play claw hammer, you know. And a lot of these fills and things will give you different ideas, and you get a lot of that open feel, where you still got all the open strings again. Which is very important, I think, to hear that, because it just makes you feel good, and instead of being so empty. So there's like some of the chords. I should go in and show you what actually some of the chords are with this, of your standard chords you would use if you're going to do songs, and you can move them around to any place you want to. But in this particular tuning, just to play your straight one chord, or your G chord as it'd be, all you got to do is just play this note here on your G fret, and you got it. Or you can use all strings. And then if you want, you got your minor there. Then you can go down here, which is standard tuning, because you got, it's just a standard D7. But then you can come up out of that and get your bottom end by hitting your low string with it. And it gets a lot fuller. And then you can come up to sort of, I don't know exactly what a lot of these names of these chords are because, but it's something. But it sounds good, and that's all that matters. Maybe someone will know. Maybe across the screen they will, they'll probably run what it is. But this is one of the chords I used, and then you can come over to this chord. This is kind of pretty. Again, there's the pedal stuff that sort of helps that happen when you keep it. Then you go up to a, note and fill it out. So that would be like a whole pattern of the chords right there. I'll do it one more time just to run through that pattern. Then you got sort of within that whole chord structure there. There's a million different ways you can put those together and get ideas. And a lot of what I'm trying to do here is recently I've got more into songwriting, and I'm trying to have someone understand that the least little thing as you're writing, you get bored with playing the same chords, and this gives you something, and it gives you a different sound to have all this open string stuff, and you hear it, and sometimes it'll give you a real good idea, and all that idea or something will come, and you might get a million seller, who knows, yeah? So I'm gonna play a little bit more in just the first part of this section of, without going into all the other changes except just real basic, mostly on the G chord, and do some little fill things with that to give you an idea of some of the fills that you can get while you're doing this thumping bass thing or moving back and forth like we started with, and just show you some of that. Like a four strings right there are still in standard guitar tuning, so if you're thinking in G, you can play, you know. You can play stuff like that. You can whatever, you know, I mean, depending on what you know and where you're at, you can still do that and still keep your bass going because it is there and it's open. Some of that other stuff, again, it's sort of like banjo. I mean, so the way I can describe it is like if you think of something, if you're playing more country or even folky, you can think of like what a banjo might play. You know, where you're hearing that. You know, that's almost like banjo licks there. And if you can get that happening with one finger and still keep this thumb going, then you get unusual kind of feel. It's almost like bluesy on the top end and banjo-y on the other end, and it just gives you a lot of different bags to create stuff in. And then when you're doing like this stuff here again, it's still back to that pedal. And within those changes, there's a million things you can play right there that fits around that. That's another side of taking the same place we were just in and taking over to a ballad side. Once again, it's still got almost a piano sound, but it's like a slow ballad piano sound. A lot of things I've run into is hearing a song on piano, and a lot of people write with a piano, and you play these things, and you can come back and hit that low note on the piano, and it sounds so full and so pretty, and then you come over and try to play it on the guitar, and it's like you're into a bar situation or something, and you just can't get that openness and that real nice feel. So with this particular G tuning here, you can do some of that and still have the same effect as you'd get on a piano without losing that nice feel, and if you're writing something, it just feels real pretty, and there's a million different directions with the changes, anything you want to do, and you also have room to open to do some licks, you know. You know, you can do that, and then you can come up and hit your low note with that, and still, okay, you can hit it first and let it sustain through, like. At and get those kind of inverted chords. They just sound real pretty to me. And but it's still basically when you're doing the things like you're doing this. I mean, I hear a piano doing it, dum, boom, dum, and they're still hitting the low note. And it's just hard a lot to do that any other way than bringing these strings down to get to keep that low end thing happening. I've written a lot of songs from when I found this tuning one time on the front porch, and a whole lot of tunes that came out. Some of them are in this place, some of them are in the middle, up-tempo, whatever, and a lot of different changes. But through that, it's just a real pleasant place to be, especially after midnight, when you're all alone, and you can just get some real pretty things if you're into trying to figure that out. It'll give you that nice ring, that nice warm feeling of a guitar instead of like on an electric. When I did the other video, we did it all electric, and the influence on electric, I let organ influence me a lot, so it's got the real blah 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 with the vibrato and all the fast licks and the do-do-do-do and like organ stuff. But over on acoustic guitar, it's a more mellow instrument, and so I relate it to more piano, and the only way I could get that happening was by stumbling up on this tuning. And then again, if it only works in G for me, you know, I mean, you can do some things in D or to make it, it's your basic thing, and do it, but to me it's much easier to learn it in one place. And then there's the old capo, you know, if you don't like it there, you can come out and capo off and put it in any key you want to. And I use capos a lot. We're not going to really get too much into capos today, it's from another place, but you can do that. So in my opinion, if you learn one thing well in one tuning, and it feels real good, you can apply it all over the place. And I like this, and I hope it's of some use of somebody out there. And I've never really played this much out in public, and this is the first time I ever tried to put it down, and it's pretty chords, and it gives you inversions of things. And once again, it's still, there's a lot of pedaling going on, you know. You keep pedaling that stuff, you know. Picking stuff if you want to and still keep that going. Sort of a mellow mood, and I'm in sort of a mellow mood, and that's why we're doing this, and I hope you like it. Thank you. That's just playing around a little bit in a more of a blues bag and kind of funky. Doing some licks, still doing some of the pedaling stuff, doing some of the bass licks, leading a little more to some lead action with it and breaking some time, but just sort of different from where we've been out here, but it's something else that I do with acoustic, and it's fun to play around with, especially like when you get down in the A section and playing some of them chords like that and using that almost Travis kind of like and you can carry it over sometimes and do those. But still trying to keep as much of the bass thing going with it as you can. Once in a while, you can break things up and play a little longer down here, as long as you got that in your mind, and come back up. You notice once in a while on that riff there and stuff I was doing, I would jump back up and do some stuff on the low end, and it still was right back at the first tape that I. Sort of gives you a nice turnaround and puts you back to the word go again, and then you can slide up and do some things that almost in a slide place, and do that kind of stuff, and one little section I did there was a, but I'm still keeping that bass thing going. It's an important matter of what I'm doing. There's a million different things you can do in that, you know. Get a whole song going right there. Yeah. And it's like when you go to the A, you can do something like it. Break off and do those. Then you put you right back in there to where you're at. But there's numerous things you can do, from listen to all the other Hot Licks videos and whatever, but I'm trying to mainly get across today is how you can break time and break. They're not really breaking time, just breaking off, but always coming back to that main thing with your bass notes and keeping that bass note happening and keep that feel going at all times, no matter what bag or what different direction, you know, that you're in there. And don't be afraid to experiment around, and even if it feels good to stay on the A for a while, maybe you stay there longer than you're supposed to, and as long as you find something that is... sounding good to you, just repeat it over and keep doing it until it feels good. But every once in a while, jump back up and catch that bass, because it'll keep everything together for you. And that goes true in any place. If you're hung up in your B change when you're doing something, B is one of the more difficult places to keep it going, because you got no place for it unless you hold it down. That's why a lot of times I come up here and resort to doing the B stuff up here. Then you can still, that's still, all that still works on the B. You can take it all the way to there, and it still works on the B. I mean, all that can work in the B, and it's using just the three notes with the pedal. At that point, I'm using three fingers to get all the three, but you can do it with two, or else you can just use these two, you know. Or you can come down here while you're doing something like that and then grab your high string. Or... Just slowing it down, but... That brings you back around to to get your turnarounds around, because some of the difficult areas is getting the turnaround and coming back out. You notice when I was playing the riff earlier, was doing the. Now on the B, I didn't go up to the B, mainly because I was missing that note. If you hit that note, it's your A, so you got to come up here, and to come up here and hit. You can, but it sounds real choppy. So instead of doing that, most people, including myself, will resort to other means. And some of those other means is you can do that stuff I was just doing there, and you can go and do things like that to get you through those changes. That's about two or three I think I did there that brings you out of the B change. Or else you can always, you know, a lot of people will change the riff when they hear you. But then you're off your little pattern, which is this. It can be done, but it's difficult. And I'm not talking about difficult stuff today. So we don't want to get into how you got to stretch to get that. Style blues that some of the early influences on my life, and there's one important chord to remember in that is that old thing when it goes down to the D changer. It's kind of a cool chord to use because you again can keep that bass thing going, you know. Yeah. And you're pedaling once more. Same thing with the long A. And, well, you can always do it in E. So if you notice, most of the stuff I was doing, I wasn't doing too much with, like, standard blues. Wasn't doing a whole lot of that. I was doing more where I could get a whole chord. A little out of tune there, but you understand. Getting whole chords and coming into sevenths. Down here still. where instead of playing just notes, you play with whole chords in mind, so you can still keep that bass thing going. Because an awful lot of the Delta style blues was done that way, because once again they had no band, they was doing it by themselves, so they had to learn to accompany themselves. And don't mean that when you got a band you still can't do it, because it shines through pretty good. But just some of the things there, I don't know. And long A's, like, you know, they refer to it as a long A country as it can be. It's a straight O A chord, but it leaves you open for. And you still got your open note happening there, so you. It's very important. Instead of, I use that some, you know, rag to A. Mostly with sevenths, if you're up there, sevenths seems to work better than straight. But the real long A here is the best position with and your D coming up to that, so you can catch that bass note to keep all that going. Sometimes you find the simplest standard chords are the real basic simple music, and there's a perfect example, because there's that. Normally you'd hit a D, but you have to change that, and that becomes a D7th, and you're just grabbing your bass. Again, Merle Travis was famous for that, and a lot of guys before him was doing it. And then down here again, you got your standard A up here, which is really a D position. A D position taken all the way up to make an A. You can come up and do the same thing with your E. Guitar discards a little old. But all those kind of things like that leaves you that open for that bass. When you go to the E, of course, you can go up. You can use it there. But then the D, you got a problem. There's no bass, so that's why you got to go to this. It leaves you open to do picking things here with your finger too while you're doing it. And you can do some of that if you like doing that stuff while you're doing. Then I went to a long A and an E position. Same chord, just take it up to the E, which is another famous old Delta blues lick that everybody used, because they was into that long A. So unfortunately, when you come down, you can go to that note, which sort of fits, but it's not quite the same. You slide back up to the long A and the D. Long A and the D. It's still better to slide back up here. It sounds a lot cooler. But the main thing of all this and what it's all about is keeping your rhythm going with acoustic guitar, getting as many open notes as you possibly can, keeping everything in a flowing, that it slides and it's sort of easy. It's not complicated. It's not fast. It's not any of those things. It's just sort of flowing, easy. And if you want to make it fast and whatever, you can do that. But I think it's very important to learn it in this slow, easy manner and get real comfortable with that. Then you can take it any place you want to. And after that, you're on your own. But this is the way I started, and I still like to play this way. And good luck to you. I hope that you learn something from this, because I learn a lot by starting this way. Thank you.